Okay, we're back in session. Next item is Mr. Bob Hughes, Economic Development Director.
All right. Good evening, Board of Commissioners. I appreciate being on the agenda again tonight and continuing in this process that you all started actually a long time before I ever came on the scene. So I'm hoping that this is the end of at least our side of it at this moment. In your package, you have, I think, several items that were actually emailed to you a little bit late last week. It's been a work in progress, really, for all the items. But hopefully you've got something that's very close to the final document. The first one would be the loan agreement. And again, that's part of a long process that we've had here. We've had several public hearings related to community development block grants and our opportunity for economic development funds coming into this community. We held a public hearing to talk about a specific project, and then you passed a resolution with the intent to apply for that $750,000. At the last meeting, you accepted a grant for $750,000, went through that paperwork. That grant stipulated the need for this company and all the grant work subsequent to that, all paper related to that, for the company to create 38 jobs for the $750,000, 60% of which would need to be low to moderate income people before they were hired there, and that the wage stipulation for that is $15.95. Those are all criteria that are built into the loan agreement that you now have in front of you. The loan agreement, again, is one of the documents that we'll use. This will be your part of it. Another piece that will be added to this will be a deed of trust that's completed by their attorneys, where we take a second position behind BB&T. We'll also have a promissory note that their attorney will put together and reviewed by our attorney and staff that will give us the opportunity to recoup these monies should something in the project go awry. The match, the $750,000, the way that program works, the improvements are made. We receive a request for payment. They show us that they paid $100 in simple math because I went to NC State, but they paid us $100 for a bill. And then we will do a request to the state of North Carolina for $50. We show them the $100 bill, we get $50 back, and we pay that to the company, all up to $750,000. Once they have, the company has 2 years to create the jobs, and then once those jobs are created, and within that two-year period, they have to keep them in place for 5 years. Every year that they keep them in place, that grant amount or that loan amount and requirement for them to pay back is reduced by 20%. So at the end of the fifth year, basically that loan that the county has made to that company is zero at that point in time, and they have satisfied the requirements of that loan. That's all part of this loan agreement that you have in front of you. And keep in mind those conditions have to be kept and met for 5 years, and that monitoring process goes on throughout that five-year process, throughout the five-year loan agreement. I don't know that I'd be more than happy to go through here. I don't know that there's any need to do that necessarily, but I'm more than happy to do that, but you have that loan agreement in front of you.
Questions of any commission?
I'd just like to review something I think I know the answers to. The deed of trust gives us one of the ways that we can recover. The way this money works is the money comes, all of it, from the state. The county doesn't have any risk involved in it as far as money, other than if the company fails to perform, then that part of the money, say they went 2 years and all of a sudden they shut down and went home, then we would owe 60% of the $750,000 back to the state that they would expect to be returned. And the purpose of that deed of trust is to protect us in that event so that we could recover part of that, our part of the money that we needed to recover. Now, the promissory note, that's on so to speak, personal property or manufacturing property, or how does the promissory note in this case differ from the deed of trust?
It will also be, this is actually the item that, where they actually state, the deed of trust is just it's an instrument. That's not really, they're not really using that instrument to tell us they're going to pay us back. The promissory note is actually what,
oh,
the instrument that pays us back.
It's the contract.
So, but it's all part of the loan agreement. Yeah. So it's all part of it. So all of it has to be there. And I think you're exactly right that, you know, if 2 years go along and something happens in that third year and it goes awry, then those are the instruments that we would use to collect, to try to collect and make best efforts. Really, that's what the state wants us to do, is make best efforts, try to get that money back.
The risk, let me do this one thing. Then the at-risk property that they have under this arrangement, is it just the real estate, or is it the manufacturing equipment, or is it both?
It's the real estate.
Just
the improvements and the improvements they will make to that real estate, because that's really what they're doing with this money is they're doubling the $750,000 and making a commitment, if they draw all that down, that they actually spend $1.5 million.
But the manufacturing equipment is not at
separate.
Risk. The machinery that they put in there is not at risk.
That's correct. That's a good point.
How about if it's attached? I mean, how about if it's bolted down?
Typically, even if it's everything leading up to the equipment, and it really depends on how they list it with their, like with the taxes here. But most of the time, and there may be some exceptions, most of the time it's counted as personal property, and that wouldn't be included in this process.
Yeah, we do. I guess the county treats it as personal property from a taxable standpoint. However, real estate law would treat it as a fixtured item. So you, I think, am I right to assume that? Yeah, could be. And so, but any improvements they make, like office space,
bathroom,
anything like that would be our property.
That's correct.
And we haven't seen the promissory note, and that's the instrument for recovery. That a lot of this has to be spelled out in the promissory note, I do believe. Right? I think so. So when we see that, we'll have a better idea.
Could the promissory note include that manufacturing equipment that they actually got the grant on?
No, the grant itself is on the upgrades to the building. It's not on the equipment.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So it's the items
That's
that Stan just outlined are exactly what, and it's real clear on the eligibility. They can't, I don't think, correct me, Mr. Hughes, but the crane, installation of a crane is not even eligible as part of this grant.
Maybe the facility to hold the crane the blocking, but not the crane, not the crane itself or the hoist itself. Okay, that's considered equipment. But, you know, if there's whatever is needed to hold it up, that would be considered a building. So it is on the building and the improvements.
I think it would stipulate, does it leave a hole when it's taken out? I mean, in our our property. And if it would leave a hole, any kind of a hole, then that hole has to be filled with money or something, recoverable money.
Mm-hmm.
Something recoverable.
We've gone through a little bit of due diligence, and that's actually through the bank itself, that they've gone through the process. We talked a little bit about that at the last meeting. Gone through the process of what that building should be valued at once those improvements are in place. So it didn't take a $2 million building to start with. It took a $1 million building, because that's really what they're paying for it, and that's the market.
It is right now.
They think the market is right now.
Yeah.
And then the improvements on top of that, and there is enough in that gap between what is owed to the bank and what the value of the building will be at the time all that's completed to recover, more than recover, the amount of money, the full amount of money of this particular loan. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I think it's best if Bob goes through his three items, and then we seek motions on individual items after he's done with his presentation, if that's all right with you.
That'll work.
Are there any more questions about the loan agreement?
No.
This is basically just a pass-through for us, this $750,000.
It really is, and there really isn't any county money into it, but by accepting that, by accepting and being part of the process, being part of that pass-through, you're taking some responsibility to make a best effort to try to recover that money should the project go south, okay?
That's, but if it goes south, we are responsible for 60% of that $750,000, according to what I heard these gentlemen say.
We're responsible for $750,000 on day one, if they spend that much, which they won't, obviously. But after year one and the grant kicks in, then we're responsible for 80%. If they've met year one and then 60%, 40%. So it goes down every year about 20%, okay? It's a forgivable loan. I mean, that's the beauty of it. So no county money, but there is some responsibility because you're accepting this and being part of the medium, if you will, to try to collect any monies. And we do that through that second lien or second deed of trust, or the second on that deed of trust. We do that through the promissory note.
And and this got to stand solid for 5 years. 3 years, what do we have to recoup if they go through this process? And on the third year, this is 5 years that they gotta keep these 40, 50 employees. Mm-hmm. If that don't happen, what is the burden on the county?
Every year for this grant,
it's prorated,
and they've got a second the same kind of grant at the city. But every year for this particular grant, they have to have 38 jobs.
38 jobs. Okay?
And if those jobs are reduced from 38 in any year, okay, then whatever percentage we have left, they've got to make good on.
And that's not our clawback against us. It's a clawback against them.
Right.
Okay.
A 38 full-time jobs, right?
Correct.
Okay. Those new hirees or transferees? The new hirees?
You know, I've been hearing a little bit about that discussion here and there.
I'd like to know the answer.
Well, I
probably they already got,
because Bill, here's a way to look at it, and I'm going to be an optimist, okay? And I think what you may be referring to is maybe a shifting of some positions from Flanders, the company they're working with, or from any other company possibly, but certainly over to, you've got, in this case, you've got three new LLCs. Two of those LLCs are companies that are actually going to be manufacturing products, okay, Pronamics and Oak Ridge Metal. Flanders was bought last year by a private equity firm. Flanders is Flanders, and they're owned by a different group. We have absolutely no idea what they're going to look like next year or 5 years from now or 10 years from now. But we do know this. We've got an opportunity to have a couple of new businesses in our community. And you know, maybe some of those people, a lot of times when companies hire people, new companies come in and hire people, half the people that they hire are working somewhere else within a 30-mile radius.
I understand that part about it, but we just have a new business.
Yeah.
And they could bring the employees right across the street from Flanders. We hadn't created 38 new jobs. We just shift some people.
Right.
I want to know that we created 38 new jobs at that company.
I think a couple of things. Everything that we are hearing now, and again, I tend to be an optimist with these kinds of things. Understand that. You know, is that there may be some shifting out there, but the 38 jobs or the 54 jobs, adding both the city and the county obligations together, are still pretty conservative over what they think they'll do in a couple of years.
Like I said, I understand that part about it is, but the reason we are investing as a county and a city is for 38 new jobs. We're not investing to transfer jobs from Flanders to the new company that's coming. We are investing in 38 new jobs.
He's right.
Yeah.
I mean, well, we did talk about
actually,
that.
and I'm not trying to play devil's advocate, but. What we're doing with this grant is we're partnering with a state grant that has conditions. Basically, what we're doing is the company wanted to upfit their building, our building. They want to buy our building and want to upfit it. They went to Raleigh and basically said, with our help, they went to Raleigh and said, we want to upfit our building. What kind of programs do you have? The state said, well, we have a building reuse program. You have to document these jobs. So what we're, so they're eligible for the program. We are kind of an agent of the state in that regard to comply, to make them comply with the state requirements. Okay. Now, the grant that he's getting ready to talk about is, we're not, the agreement stipulates jobs, but we're more involved in that grant as far as investment of our tax base.
I understand what you're saying, Mr. Christman, but I still, I mean, it's just like if you can build a KFC side of King Chicken. Are you going to take the workers from King Chicken and carry the KFC and you created 38 new jobs? That's the question that I'm asking.
I understand.
Mr. Chairman, you said that Flanders Filters has been bought by somebody else. So none of the principals in Pronamic are still affiliated with Flanders Filters.
No, they are. They're still affiliated with them.
So that's just like if Sheets moves into town and takes F. Ray Moore's employees, hopefully F. Ray Moore will have to hire more employees across the street there if he's still got business after Sheets moves into town, right? So hopefully, even though the job's transferred, then there's going to be an opening somewhere else. And that would be the way I would see Flanders in this thing. Flanders, if somebody leaves Flanders because they like the, it's a Smith guy, right?
Yes.
If somebody leaves Flanders, like say I'm working at Flanders and I work for Mr. Smith, and he goes over to Pronamics and I liked him a lot, and he says, well, you want to come to work for me? I go over and work for him because I liked him. Right. But that hopefully will leave an opening at Flanders. Is that not what you would hope that would be the case?
Yeah, that's right.
That if Flanders wouldn't cut that position.
Right.
That's how.
And again,
I guess, Ed, that's what I'm saying. The job's going to be there, but you don't know for sure.
I understand exactly what you're saying, but I was just trying to get me a clear picture here. Because if I was these guys, I would go to Flanders and make sure I got my 38 employees and heck with what Flanders do.
Yeah.
I got the monkey off my back.
I'd do the same thing.
Yeah.
I had worked with those people at Flanders, and I know they're good employees, and I'm going to try to get them to work for me. I'm surprised it's not a non-compete clause out there somewhere.
Well,
I don't understand it.
I wouldn't put a non-compete clause in there if I were going to get some of the same folks.
Let me ask this question. Considering you're an optimist. Robert says he's about halfway. I guess I'm somewhere in between. Say that they do, as Robert said and Ed says, and they go and get these guys and they get that monkey off their back.
I would.
Is there any callback that the state has? We have no callback is what you're saying, but do they have a callback? Does the state have one?
For CDBG, there are requirements. Those are federal dollars.
Uh-huh.
And there are some stipulations about how those dollars are allocated. Okay, and if we're talking about, there is something in that document somewhere that talks about that it can't affect a closing in anywhere else in the country.
Okay.
So we've run into situations where we're working with a company in New York that was going to shut down. Well, CDBG programs were not available to us for that. So there's some oversight on that.
Whose responsibility is it for the oversight?
We will have Kevin Richards, who actually wrote the application, is on retainer, or Mideast is on retainer, and they handle all of that oversight. But we're going to be working with them. And I think, you know, there's going to be really a pretty close relationship because we've got the same thing going on at the city.
But ultimately, Bob, the state is the one that does the ultimate determination on whether they successfully created the jobs or not.
Yeah, audits, all that.
They're the regulatory agent of these funds.
Well,
so
we may not be the whistleblower. It can be anyone in the community that could blow that whistle and say, look, they didn't create the jobs.
Well, and what happens is Kevin Richards accumulates all the paperwork that documents the jobs. He sends the information to the Department of Commerce, and they yay or nay it.
In other words, previous employment, Flanders Filters, present employment, Pronamics, that could be a nay.
Every employee that gets hired by these companies will will have to get information about their previous employment.
Yeah.
Okay? And what they were earning, because remember that's 60% low to moderate income.
There's going to be some.
It's going to be.
It's complex.
I'm telling you, it's really nice to have partners like through the Department of Commerce and some of these other programs out there, because it really, it's a team approach.
Yeah, it takes the onus off of you if you have to say, hey, you're not doing right.
Right.
Yeah. Well, Kevin, somebody's got to play police.
I'm not against the project. Yeah. I just want to make sure that 6 months down the road that to come here in the county had to come off with a hip full of money.
Yeah, I don't want.
That's the only thing I'm worried about.
I just want to get rid of this building. That's why I'm voting for it.
Okay. I hear all your concerns.
Yeah. Go ahead with
you. Next one. All right. Next is something that we discussed. We've discussed previously several times in closed sessions. We talked about this entire project. We held a public hearing at the last meeting for you to consider providing an incentive grant or a forward-funded grant to Project Blue Goose. We talked a little bit about the structure of that that grant program. Now you actually have the documentation. Last month or last meeting, you agreed through resolution or by resolution that you would enter into this program or into this agreement with the company once you see the actual documentation. Again, I mentioned that we're talking about three new LLCs. They're all mentioned in this document. There's Blue Goose, the real estate LLC, and the other two companies, Pronamic and Oak Ridge Metal, who are the manufacturing companies. In total, when we look at this project, we're looking at and how we based the numbers. We're looking at a total number of 54 jobs, and I got that number from 38 here and 16 at the city. So a total of 54 jobs for both Pronamic and Oak Ridge Metal, and that they invest over the next couple of years $9.4 million, and that's new both real estate value and machinery value that we will see on the books by January 1, 2015. Okay, if we see that value, whatever value there is, and but up to that value of $9.4 million on the books, and I can tell you today, Ed, that we're probably not going to see a $9.4 million, but that was the best guess number that we had at this point in time. Because machinery, the way it is depreciated, the way it's counted by the county may be different than some of the actual values out there, and certainly the real estate is done differently by the North Carolina Department of Revenue and the schedules that the county uses for that. So I've seen instances where there was a big discrepancy about what the company actually spent on a building and the machinery, and what actually ended up on the books. So, and there, you know, of course, then we start asking questions as well. But it was all legit. So, what we're looking at is in January 1, 2015, $9.4 million, whatever that number is, $9.4 million or less on the books. Then we see what taxes will be paid on that. On January 31st of 2016, so we're talking 3 years down the road, we would make a payment based on what we saw on the books January 1 of 2015. Okay, so it's a forward funded grant. The grant begins at that point, and we would make for 5 years payments up to $20,602, and that would be the maximum. More than likely, I think it's going to be short of that. Hopefully it won't. Maybe it'll be all of it and more, but we won't pay any more than that.
What is the value of the equipment based on?
We use a $5.3 million number.
I mean, what was it for us to find out in relation to what's on the books? Is that maintained at the local tax department?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. All of that is listed every January as personal property. That's mandated by law that all companies do that.
Okay. One other question I forgot to ask about. These are both new startup companies.
Yes.
At this point in time, will Flanders be their only customer?
Yes.
Do they have plan on expanding out from Flanders? Okay.
Yeah. And for something like this, that's a blessing and a curse, and I don't need to get... Right. It's a blessing that you have a contract to provide material.
It's a curse that you only have one.
And a curse that you only have one. But, you know, it's not a bad way to start out, actually. So I can go through all of this, but the bottom line is we're looking for the same type of information. We will do the due diligence on this along with staff, you know, to make sure that what gets on the books and what actually gets paid out in taxes, and then the recommendation of what should be paid to the company at that time. They will be providing us with information regarding the per hour average wages for those employees. And then we have ways and means in this contract right here to recover, or not to recover, but to actually reduce the amount of payment based on what's actually happened there. So we have that ability in this contract.
And one thing to consider is, even if they fail down 3 years down the road, we have leverage. Plus, we have a building that's upfit and is ready for somebody else to move into. The upfit's no longer required.
Okay, your next item.
All right, the third item has to do with the corner lot, that land that we talked about, also at the public hearing at our last meeting. Our county attorney, Billy Ball, has drawn up a document. I have called it a buy-sell agreement. It's not a buy-sell, but it acts like that. And I'll let Billy discuss that if that's okay.
What that is, Commissioner, is it's on this corner lot. It's about 5.79 acres. It's going to be conveyed to Blue Goose LLC. And it's going to be a fee title to the property. It'll be conveyed to Blue Goose. But they'll have a restriction. It'll be subject, of course, to the industrial development park restrictions. But also, it'll have a provision in it that Blue Goose cannot sell that parcel of land, that tract, 5.79 acres, in any period less than 10 years without consent of the commission, Beaufort County. So you're literally... And the theory being that the lot had parcel has a value, I believe, about $86,000, I believe, Mr. Hughes.
Right.
That is going to be recovered in that period of time over that 10 years for your recruitment of taxes. You literally give it away, but you get it on the tax books, and you get that in taxes in lieu of the county owning that property.
Any questions from anybody?
Mr. Chairman, as you consider your adopting these three agreements, I want to also point out, and this was a major discussion originally when you considered the sale of that building, what was it, 6-7 months ago maybe, that we started this process, but I think Mr. Hughes can attest to this, but because I was out there last week, but the natural gas line has gone in. And they have installed that, and that was part of the stipulation when you all agreed to take less for that building than initially than you wanted to. One of the factors that this company brought to the table was that they would have natural gas run to the industrial park, and because of the location of the blue building, that the running of that natural gas is all the way to the end of the park, and that is a substantial benefit to us. And any other future development that happens in that park, as well as the Briley farm that it ran through from 264.
So that worked mighty fine for you guys in the jail, right?
We're not talking about a jail now, Stan.
Mr. Chairman, if you all will address, maybe if you all consider a motion for each one of those items, I think, unless you all have further questions for Mr. Hughes.
Any further questions? Okay. What's the pleasure of the board?
Separately or all together?
Separately.
Which one's first?
Mr. Chairman, the first one would be, we would request a motion of the loan agreement between the county and Pronamic Industries for the $750,000, which is the CDBG grant that the county is going to be entering into the loan agreement with the company for.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Have a motion, is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion?
Well, I just want to make a comment. I'm going to vote for this primarily because it helps us to get rid of the blue goose, which is the albatross that's been around our neck for some time. There's a lot of pressure on some of us to vote against this, but we have more collateral to protect the county against a default on the part of these people than we have ever had on any other one of these deals that we've ever gone into. We also have more clarity, thanks to Mr. Utes and the work the manager and the assistant manager and the county attorney have done, than we have ever had on one of these deals. This thing's not slathered with snake oil like these things have been in the past. There is risk to the county. I'm aware of that, but that risk, my understanding, is sufficiently collateralized that we do not have to take money out of our pocket at the end of the day in order to do what we need to do. The other thing that a lot of people are overlooking on this particular deal is when you look at a company that is offering to spend $9 million in Beaufort County for an economic development project, I mean, while we have had some really bad luck with our economic development projects, it is a great thing that we have people who are willing to spend that amount of money. Now, there are risks here. There's no doubt about it. And there's a lot of people who are aware of these risks other than me, and there's a lot of work being done to dig into some of this stuff. So I'm going to vote for it simply because it lets us get rid of the building, and we do have collateral, which we've never had before.
Yeah, and I'd like to say something nice. I'm going to vote for it as well for my own set of reasons, and that is to get rid of our property. And I'll probably vote for the next one that comes along, providing it's handled as well as this one was handled. And to what Hood was saying, I agree. We've known up front what our costs are going to be. We've known all through the negotiations what's been going on. This is one we kind of handled ourselves. And there is a certain level of clarity. Commissioners, now that we have economic development under us and not under some other group, we are going to know these things up front, and I think it's better. We're going to have more responsibility on us, but we're going to have more knowledge as well, which will be better. So I appreciate the job you've done, because I remember when you were the only guy who could talk to somebody at one time, and you did a good job with that. I'm going to stay with the program on this one.
I appreciate the job Mr. Hughes has done too. And I also understand that the reason we're getting rid of this building is because we want to get rid of the blue goose. But on the same other token, I have mixed emotion about whether it'd be cheaper to keep the blue goose than pay off 3 years down the road. That's the dilemma that I have. The other dilemma that I have is I want to make sure that these people get the jobs that they are promised. If we invest the taxpayers' money with the promise of jobs, I want to see jobs, and I don't want what we have is what we used to call voodoo economics. I want to see jobs.
All right. All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, 7-0. Next motion.
Mr. Chairman, the next motion would be for the grant agreement between the county and Blue Goose LLC. This is the performance agreement that states that the county will provide a grant equal to 50% of taxes paid to the company for any increase in the tax base that they create.
What's the pleasure of the board?
Well, now there's a cap on that.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry. I was summarizing it, as stated in the agreement that Mr. Hughes provided.
About $100,000 cap.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. Excuse me.
Okay.
$20,000 a year over 5 years. Then.
Yeah.
Well, and that is money that we don't take out of pocket and give them up front. That money is on the back end.
That's right.
They pay us first, and then we pay them back.
That's right.
It's not a guarantee of $20,000 every year. It's a guarantee after they document that they have increased the tax base by a certain amount.
Yes, up to $20,000.
Yes, sir. And historically, the way we've handled these, just for the new commissioners, is we bring you the information. You aren't giving us carte blanche to write a check for these when the time comes, when the company meets their requirements. We bring these to you at a meeting such as this, we document, and then we get budgetary authority to make that appropriation. So you're approving the agreement, we bring it before you at a later date to actually get budgetary authority to issue the grant.
I make that motion, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion. Is there a second? All right, I'll make the second. Any further discussion?
Yeah, I just want to reiterate the reason I'm voting for this. Oh, because I want to get rid of this property. And there's going to come a point in time I'm not going to be voting for any of this. I don't care how good the deal is. But right now, as long as we've got the property and we've got to get rid of it, I'm voting for it.
Anything further? All in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed, 7-0. Next motion.
Mr. Chairman, the last one is the buy-sell agreement for the 5.78 acres of land to Blue Goose LLC, the corner lot. As was provided you information from your county attorney.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, raise your right hand. Opposed? 6-1. We thank you.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you guys, and I appreciate the support for this project. Just keep in mind, we're in a competitive situation. There are no guarantees with any of this stuff, but you, I think, have shown that the county is ready to do business, and we're going to keep on doing business if the project is a good project for this community. So hopefully it'll all work out for the best for everybody. Thank you.
And we don't have any more shell buildings after this one.
Well, I was getting ready to come to you.
Hey, we can do a very quick vote.
It's a whole different side of stand if
we can do a very quick vote.
You got me to the vote.